Resource Center recognizes the many Indigenous nations who have long-standing relationships with the territories upon which our campuses are located that precede the establishment of York University. We acknowledge our presence on the traditional territories of the Mississaugas and New Credit, the Huron-Wendat, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, and the Métis Nation of Ontario. Professor Deb McGregor is an associate professor of Osgoode Hall Law School in the Faculty of Environmental Studies and is the Canada Research Chair in Indigenous Environmental Justice. Her work considers the interface between theory and practice of environmental justice scholarship by engaging with Indigenous intellectual traditions. Her research provides a much deeper understanding of environmental injustices facing Indigenous peoples, and even more importantly, the approaches we may use to address them. Of course, she's well published in a variety of national and international journals, delivers numerous talks, and one of which will be here tonight. Prior to joining Osgoode, Professor McGregor was an associate at the Department of Geography at the University of Toronto and served as a policy advisor for the Aboriginal Relations of Environment Canada Ontario Region. She's an Anishinaabe from White River First Nation. Please join me in welcoming Deb to give a talk tonight. Thank you.
Acknowledgements are given, which you should be starting to hear more frequently because colleges and universities signed some sort of agreement that said they would do this. But also, I want you to think about it in terms of being, this is Toronto, and actually, I thought about this. I have so many presentations, and I never, when I talk about where I'm from, I never say Toronto, even though I've been here for like 30 years. I would always show pictures of where I come from because I still kind of relate in that way. But then when I talk about Toronto, I think about the ancestors that were here and the thousands of years of history that was here prior to contact, prior to before anybody had to have a land claim, because that's a very colonial kind of process. So a lot of the times there's recognition of the Mississaugas and New Credit, as there should be, but that's still a very limited way of thinking about this territory and the people that were here and the ancestors. That were here for thousands of years, who had knowledge, who were negotiating treaties, who were, you know, taking care of this place so that we could be here. So thinking about that thousands of years, not just recently when there was a specific land claim and someone got a land claim, but there's actually a history here. And that we're the descendants of those ancestors. It doesn't matter where you come from. If you're here, then we're benefiting from this territory, and with that comes responsibilities to future generations. So how are we going to take care of this territory? What are our responsibilities going to be? So one of the reasons why I think about this, I was asked this question at the, at UD, I can't remember, Gordon Foundation, people walk through. So someone said, so when someone says, oh, when they're giving the land acknowledgement, like a lot of the times it sounds kind of token. Like, what do you think about that? I don't think I got to answer that question, or maybe I did. But I just said, it's only token if you make it token. Like, it's, you know, these things can be scaled up and down. If you take it seriously, then it will be. Are you taking it seriously that you're a person of responsibility on this territory and you're honoring what the ancestors have done to ensure sustainability for future generations? Like, a lot of that's up to you. You don't need anyone's permission to be a responsible, sustainable human being on the territory. So it's not a token gesture if you take it seriously. Like, even if someone says it, maybe they don't, doesn't mean that that's how you have to respond. So I think that acknowledgement is really important in acknowledging that thousands of years of history and acknowledging thousands of years into the future. Hopefully, if we learn to behave ourselves a little bit better in relation to the natural world, which I'll talk about. So some of the main findings, you'll be familiar with this if you're familiar with the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. One of the main findings of cultural genocide of Indigenous peoples. So the commissioners thought about this, like that's kind of a controversial word to be using. Apparently, I don't know, it seemed obvious to me my whole life, but apparently people would get uptight about that. But that's the truth. So that's the truth of the matter. And that's a picture of the Spanish residential school that my mother went to. Because that's part of the whole legacy of the residential school system, just to sort of give you an image of it. Think about how it doesn't look that much different than other buildings might be. But cultural genocide was one of the main findings from the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Whether people really wanted to hear that or not. Now, one of the other things that pointed out that I think is really important, particularly in how we choose to respond to the Truth and Reconciliation and any of the recommendations, is he said that Canada is systemically, institutionally, and structurally very racist and colonial. So the one-offs really isn't going to work. Or doing more of the same isn't really going to work. You have to actually do something quite different. So I think getting a handle on what we're doing and it's not working, to, okay, what is it that we have to do that is going to work? But basically that's what he said. So you have to really think about the structures of things. And there's implications for that for post-secondary, or any kind of education, but post-secondary. Post-secondary education as well. Things that we consider to be normal or not normal. I was in a meeting yesterday morning, actually, with a number of educators on sustainability. And they had asked me this question in terms of the, Shayla, you might be familiar with these kind of things as well, is, Charlotte, sorry, is trying to accommodate, you know, First Nations, Métis, or Inuit culture in elementary and secondary schools. And they said, well, you know, like the smudge, you know, we have this no smudge policy, and I'm like, well, it's not really the same. But all this drama around what kind of culture can you accommodate in these kind of places, like ceremony, and I said, well, here's the thing, like for us, like you just, the way schools are, you just consider to be normal. But for us, it's not. Like you have your own ceremonies, you have your own protocols, you have your own ways of doing things that you just consider to be normal. Aboriginal stuff is like abnormal and you're trying to fit it in and it doesn't fit very nicely. Then I shared a story about my York breach of protocol and ceremony. But so the day before, I had been in someone's PhD defense. And now at U of T, when someone successfully defends, whoever the chair of the committee is goes out and says, congratulations, doctor, whoever, right? And then they're all happy because they're pretty darn stressed out. They're left outside the door while people are making decisions about your future. Kind of stressful. So that's what you do. So someone goes out to get the candidate. I'm sitting there and I go, congratulations. And everybody scowls at me. I'm like, didn't you already know before I said that? And I wasn't the chair of the committee. I said, oh, I just breached your ceremonial protocol and who's supposed to tell the candidate that they got there? Anyway, but it's just an example that people, there's protocols here. It's there, like there's ceremony here that no one thinks about as being odd until you come from somewhere else. So it was actually Jeff Hewitt, who's a colleague, like he's going to the University of Windsor, who pointed out everything that we think is normal is actually protocol and ceremony in another place. And then there's all this drama around how you can accommodate Aboriginal thousands of years it was the norm. It's only recently that it hasn't been. So I continue to embarrass myself. But it was a teaching moment. So you're probably wondering, like, what the heck does that have to do with Truth and Reconciliation? Believe me, I was wondering the same thing when I was in this moment. I really remember this moment. But so one of the things that the Truth and Reconciliation pointed out was that Indigenous peoples aren't the problem. He was really trying to shift that kind of narrative from, let's study the Indians, they're the problem, these are problems, let's get rid of this problem, to it's actually Canada, like there's a bigger thing, it's just not an Indigenous issue. So Sesame Street, so I was at, I guess it was a conference a number of years ago, where so I call it, like, the Royal Smart People were called together. I don't know why I was there, but it was this conference. It was people like Justice Linden as part of the Lodge, you know, ex-Prime Minister Paul Martin, like all these, like, fancy people, you know, that were there, and who were called together to try to talk about the Indigenous problem. So right off the hop, I'm like, seriously? I think I was the only Indigenous woman there. Maybe there was only, like, three women there, period, and it was all the Royal Smart People were all basic things. For the most part. So it reminded me of Sesame Street. Remember, who knows Sesame Street? Like, I'm dating myself. But Sesame Street used to have this little skit of the Royal Smart Person, the Royal Smart People. So the king would have this really silly question, and he'd call in the Royal Smart People, and they'd all come in, and they're trying to figure out how to solve this, the king's problem. So all the Royal Smart People were there trying to solve the Indian problem again. So that's why Sesame Street started. Like, I'm with the Royal Smart People, and we're trying to solve this Indian problem. So we were encouraged to prohibitions at the door, which sometimes isn't a good idea, especially some. So people are talking about what they think, you know, the Indigenous problem is. And people are saying what I thought were pretty lame things, like, kind of, well, it's monoholism. Like, seriously? Like, people still think that now? Like, aren't we, like, so past that? But in a very superficial thing, things that are actually symptoms of deeper rooted problems. And then a prominent person who I haven't called out all the time, I haven't publicly said, I'm such an idiot, but anyway, so it was his turn, and he had this metaphor that Indigenous peoples, or Aboriginal peoples, were Humpty Dumpty, and we fell off the wall, and we're all these little pieces, and why don't we just get our act together, pull our pieces together. So I sat there stunned at first, because it was, to me, it was a very violent thing to say. And then I got really, really angry. You know when you get really, really angry? So I'm so angry, my heart's racing. And my stomach, like, I'm sick to my stomach that I'm hearing this from people who are supposed to be like the real smart people. But you know Sesame Street, they're actually not, right? They can't figure it out. But anyway, so I don't often lose it in public, but I did then. This is, okay, no one is saying anything. Like, this ridiculous thing was said, like, Humpty Dumpty. Like, I can't even imagine, like, it was such a silly thing to say. And but no one said anything. And there was a few other Indigenous people there, I think a couple of chiefs. And prior to that, they had been talking about, drawing on the Royal Commission, that, you know, the relationship was a big part of the problem. Like, that's kind of like the bigger picture. All this other stuff is sort of symptomatic of things gone wrong there. Anyway, so I finally snapped, and I just said, well, here's the thing. Like, somebody built a wall. It wasn't Humpty Dumpty. Somebody pushed Humpty Dumpty up the wall, or a society pushed Humpty Dumpty up the wall, the same society that built the wall, pushed Humpty Dumpty up the wall, and then pushed Humpty Dumpty off the wall, and then had the nerve to say, why don't you get your act together? I think I probably used words like psycho and other things. When I was on my big rant, but I was livid. Like, it was sort of like, you know, that big thought bubble that you have, and you know you shouldn't say those things out loud, but then it burst. And then I said, so in this image, and I picked this one of all the Humpty Dumpty images, I hope you Dumpty on Google come up, because the other part of the poem is that Humpty Dumpty falls off the wall and all the king's horses and men, so that's the crown, the king, tries to put Humpty Dumpty back together again, and then can't, right? So I'm thinking, so if you're really going to use that metaphor, then see it to its logical conclusion, which is, you're not going to be able to solve this. You know, because when you see the problem wrong in the first place. So that's my Humpty Dumpty story. So I was traumatized to the point where I had a hard time talking about it, or even to talk about it, because I would get so mad. I would clench my hands. But anyway, so after my rant, all the Native people came and sat beside me. And then he just said, oh, I retract that, you know, Humpty Dumpty. We go, it's too late. You put it out there. We don't go Humpty Dumpty now. But partly, I think what the Truth and Reconciliation Commission was doing was challenging that, saying, no, like, Humpty Dumpty isn't the problem. Because that's how, that, and, you know, unfortunately, that's also a lot of scholarship. A lot of scholarship in having to do with Indigenous peoples is Humpty Dumpty scholarship. Like, it's like, okay, there's this problem, how do we solve it, without thinking about what the bigger picture is, or seeing Indigenous peoples as being a problem and deficit in some way. So, on the one hand, it enraged me, but it was symptomatic. He was talking about a larger attitude that a lot of people have. So we have to think about that. What kind of scholarship are we perpetuating when we're here? So that's Humpty Dumpty. Got that off my chest. We can move on. So again, some of the context, we're saying Indigenous women and girls. So when I think about this, so this was a recommendation also that came from Truth and Reconciliation Commission. You know, call for inquiry, which I'm assuming is getting still worked on right now. I haven't seen any news about, is there any news about the actual inquiry? I don't think so. So the question I ask myself is, what will the inquiry change? So as an Indigenous woman, I think, will an inquiry actually change the bigger context that I live in? As an Indigenous woman, am I still sane? Or am I nieces and nephews, or will my children be safe? So, what is the inquiry actually going to change about living in Canada and being safe as an Indigenous woman? So I think it, again, speaks to those bigger structural kind of problems and issues that we actually really have to tackle and start to meet them. And it's actually really hard to do that because you're not, when it's systemic and institutional, it's hard, it's often hard to put your finger on it. So it becomes very tricky. But I think it's important too because, you know, people aren't safe in Canada. And I think this is a good example of, the kind of level where we need to tackle these kind of concerns. And again, and it's not murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls isn't the issue. That's just what we're seeing because of the other stuff that's going on. But it tends to be framed that way. So this was, I remember this, it was actually around the same time that I went to the Humpty Dumpty conference, and where Justice Sinclair was on, their interim report had been released. So he made it very clear, it's not an Indigenous problem. It's a Canadian problem. He was really trying to reframe how we thought about the residential school mandate that they were given. I realized this actually in 2016, so it's 20 years after the Royal Commission on Aboriginal People. And again, we have to think, how far have we come? Like, what are we doing differently after 2 decades? 10 years from now, or I guess 2025, 10 years after the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, what are our reflections going to be on that work? Or after however many years after the inquiry on murder and missing Indigenous women and girls. But I think, so I wanted to acknowledge the work of the Royal Commission because it did have a broader mandate than the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. Truth and Reconciliation was more specific. RCAP was a lot bigger. So TRC isn't going to deal with certain things that have to be addressed in Canada to deal with those systemic kind of issues as well. But I don't like to forget it because people did do good work there. I mean, it didn't get followed up on in the way that we would have wanted, but it didn't. I'd like to refer to Thomas King. Again, to me, this is very much relevant to scholarship. Do we even ask the right questions? So if we're framing the Indian problem, means our problem, and this has been around a really long time, and I am not entirely convinced it's changed all that much, but I love this quote in his book where he starts to reframe it. He says, we're asking the wrong questions. It's rarely ever about what we want. It's usually about what somebody else wants from us or our friend. So thinking about it, like really thinking about, like, what are our questions? Like, what kind of answers are we actually really looking for in our scholarship? Because the scholarship in universities really influences public policy. It influences or real people's lives, depending on the nature of your research. But really trying to shift. We'll see if we're successful in doing that. That's too much time. So, what is reconciliation? So this is how the Truth and Reconciliation Commission defines it. And I look at that and I'm thinking, it's a verb. It's not like this thing. It's actually a process. It's something that you actually, and like any process, it probably means you have to work at it. It probably means it's going to change and it's going to transform over time because it's actually a process. Because it isn't the first time that people have talked about that we need to have better relationships. So that's, you can search all over the place, thousands of pages, and I'm always trying to find, like, what do they actually really mean by reconciliation? I also wanted to, so that's sort of how the TRC kind of talks about reconciliation. But the part that I'm really taken with in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, and it's probably my lens, my environment sustainability lens, is talking about the reconciliation that also has to happen with the planet, also has to happen with the earth. It basically says that there will not be reconciliation among people unless you reconcile the relationship with the earth itself. And again, there's thousands of years of history here and knowledge that can inform that. It's not like insurmountable thing to know. So he talks about it when you find the section in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission saying it's you have to be very careful not to have a very narrow view of what it is that you have to think about in a broader way from an Indigenous point of view or an Indigenous knowledge point of view. So we have to think about that too. And they are talking about, we did in a lot of our early treaties. We talked about the relationship. But explicitly and implicitly, it also was talking about sustainability and the earth. So reconciliation of it. So there's, you know, people who are very critical of reconciliation, and I think actually what they're reacting to is what they're often referring to as the colonial view of reconciliation. So these are just a couple of examples. The new need consult and accommodate, the federal guidelines, also the self-government policy. Essentially, a colonial view of reconciliation is the Crown is sovereign, and what they're trying to do is reconcile Aboriginal treaty rights with the Crown's sovereignty, as opposed to recognition of Indigenous sovereignty. Like, Aboriginal treaty rights are this problem that has to be solved and reconciled and so on. That's not what TRC is saying, and that's not what Indigenous people are saying. So I'm finding that maybe there's a little bit of coming around to kind of realize that isn't what TRC talks about at all, and the Reconciliation Covenant is actually challenging that view of the colonial reconciliation process. So it's very much a reaction to that that needs to get sorted out. About a month ago, I was at the Research Center at the University of Manitoba. In a session on the reconciliation people versus the resurgence people. And again, I have no idea where I fit in there. I'm just like, why am I here? I'm into binaries. And it turned out, but you know, when it really came down to it, people were talking about the same thing. They were kind of just using different vocabulary. They were actually maybe more like a Venn diagram than completely opposed. What I will say, one of the problems I had with that particular session was, it was pretty well only academics, and this is the day, the morning on the news was the First Nation of Manitoba declared a state of emergency over a suicide. I'm thinking, why aren't we talking about that? You got the Royal Smart People, another group of Royal Smart People, I don't know again why I'm there, and we're not even talking about like real problems, we're like debating ideology. Like, I really doubt anybody there cares about this stuff we just spent all day talking about. So I think a lot of this has to be rooted in what communities actually need, what communities actually want. And I did write that in the online evaluation that I sent. I'll probably never get invited again. So, relationships. So what is it about relationships? And I've said this a number of times. Apologies to those who have heard me rant on about relationships before. So when we talk about relationships, what do we mean? You know, I think in this room, you all, but we've all been in relationships that have been challenging, maybe even dysfunctional, like not good, but they can also change over time. They can also be in really good relationships. So when we say relationships, we have to know what we mean. Like, what kind are we talking about? Like, the current one, not so good, right? So we need to actually be really clear about what we're talking about in relationships. So is it one based on conflict? Sometimes you need to have conflict in order to get to resolution. Treaties that I know about, but what kind of relationship are we talking about? because they can change. Are we talking about, like what Cindy Blackstock's talking about, are we going to do this all over again? Are we going to come back 10 years after TRC and have the same conversation, or after murder missing an Indigenous woman? Are we actually going to have different kind of conversations? What kind of relationship are we going to have? What does it look like? Hopefully it's not characterizing the current one. And the thing about relationships, if you're in a relationship that works, however, and usually any kind of relationship is going to have its ups and downs, because being able to work through them is actually knowledge and skill and insight and strength, all kinds of things you learn from tough times, right? So in relationships, when they get really tough, that's when you have to work really hard, not run away in the opposite direction, which is sort of like the history of, you know, treating relationships with Aboriginal people, right? As soon as things got hard, then people just bend and shift, sort of, you know. So, but think about it. When people mean relationship, think about what that really means. I know how much work it is. Every day you have to work at it, you know. And if you don't, then, you know, things happen. You don't know about it. Everyone's surprised. Like, oh God, ooh, what's going on? You better appoint a commission. Why are we all surprised, right? So you actually have to work at relationships and not run away in the opposite direction as soon as it becomes tough. So the Covenant of Reconciliation, so this is getting into text. So when I looked at the Covenant of Reconciliation, I went, wow, like, you know, that sounds like kind of neat. Again, because I hadn't really paid much attention to it. is what it calls for. So that sounds good, you know, because again, this is where it's challenging, you know, the current self-government policy, current consultation and accommodation policy, UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, some of the same relationships that have already been talked about in the RCAP report. So this all, like, this sounds like something, you know, we should be doing. Why not? UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People. Again, I have my environmental. The other reason why I like to point this out is they also speak to responsibility. So a lot of the times, the rights discourse tends to dominate, but there's also a responsibilities component there that often gets ignored, but it's actually becoming, well, people are talking about it a lot more now, the responsibilities component of that whole narrative. This is where it talks about Indigenous legal orders, laws. So, I look at that and I'm like, those are good things to happen, right? Like, those are not bad things. Why not? But surprisingly, the whole panel went, no! Like, geez, like, why do we want, like, more stuff on top of everything else that we're doing? So when you take a moment to think about it, why do we need such a covenant? Like, what, like, why? Like, what's going on that we need to have this kind of covenant? And whose interest will it serve? What serves as the basis of the covenant to action? So when you think about treaties, like, there's always this basis to it. Like, what's going to be the basis of the covenant, like, dysfunctional relationships? Like, what's the basis of this? And do we have what it takes to actually implement this? If we haven't been so good at the treaties that do exist, like, what are we doing dramatically different, like, tomorrow that's going to make this an actual reality? Are we actually ready? So that's the other question, like, are we actually ready to do this? Because what it means is, for there to be balance and equity and harmony means people who have power are going to have to give some of that up. And so far, we've always been jumping up and down super keen to do that. So it requires, like, you have to think about it. Like, what does this mean to have a reconciliation covenant? How is that different than the direction we've already got with the current treaties? Like, what's different there than what people have already been saying? So when you start thinking about it, you're like, I don't know. Like, maybe it should have already been like that in the first place. This is almost like, you know, doing correcting tape or something and trying to change the relationship. What's our vision for what that relationship should be? Like, what kind of vision is that, you know, reconciliation covenant trying to achieve? And I like this particular image, again, because I think that idea has to also include the earth. It just can't be about me. One thing that the Royal Commission on Aboriginal Peoples, the Upper Washington Cree, and others have said, when there's conflict, it usually has to do with land. So we actually have to really sort that out. But we also have to think about, what do we want? Like, what was it trying to achieve? What's our vision? We work a lot harder if we know what we're working towards, as opposed to, maybe it's dysfunctional, we need to have something different, but then what do we want then? What is it that we want? And again, unfortunately, as scholars and academics, we're really good at describing problems, not so good at being visionary. So, for me, that starts with creation. A lot of our instructions for how to behave properly in the world, there's all kinds of instructions that come from all kinds of places. But for me, a lot of it starts with creation. How do you behave properly in the world? And that includes behaving properly with other people, behaving properly with the earth, or nature, whatever you want to call it, behaving properly with the ancestors, with the future generations, with the spirit world. Like, it's pretty big. But you're learning how to do that. You're not left without any instruction for how to go about this work. So this is, so I just wanted to talk a little bit about Indigenous law and legal orders. So if you really want to know, like, you should read John Boyle's 400-page book on Indigenous Constitution, where he spends a lot of time talking about Indigenous law, so that's where I'm drawing from. But Indigenous peoples, basically what I want to say is we had our own legal orders. So when I talk about in this territory for thousands of years, people were doing not just randomly wandering around, people had orders, society, history, education, you know, justice and legal traditions, their own intellectual traditions, you know, complete societies. So they're not new. The interest in them is new, but they're not. Like, they've been there. And how do these play into, you know, relationships and reconciliation. So laws all around us. So this is M.A. Kraft, Anishinaabe legal scholar at the University of Manitoba. She's also now the director for the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. So laws all around us. A lot of it comes from the land itself. The ability to be able to read it, to understand what's there. I think a lot of our problem now is, a lot of us don't know how to do it. Recently I was at, I don't even know what you would call it, I guess a gallery. And one of the elders there just said, the messages are there all the time. It's just that we're not able to hear it. Which implies that maybe we're not ready, we don't know how, but it's already there. And it's, we don't have the capacity to be able to do that. But it's all around us. And that's where we would learn it. Indigenous justice and law. How do we see harmony? Why do we do it? That's a big part of it. I also think about Indigenous research being very much that way. How do we conduct ourselves properly in the world? We know that the current system isn't working. So again, doing more of the same. So think about the kind of issues that face a community like Ottawa that's been in the news. So going in and doing more of the same that's not working doesn't, to me, seems kind of illogical. The current system isn't working. The current laws and justice system, it's not working for the earth either. Read the UN reports on climate change and water, not looking good. So it's not working. So we need to do something different. And I think what the TRC was saying and others is that Indigenous law, conceptions of Indigenous law and justice might help us do that. Might help us think differently about these kind of things. M.A. Kraft talks about responsibilities being at the heart of it. So you have a broader discourse around Aboriginal treaty rights, which is very much focused on rights. These get defined in the courts, and people get upset when things, all kinds of people get upset about all kinds of things when things go into court, because usually means somebody wins and somebody loses. But she frames it in a different way. So does John Burroughs, obligations and duties. Like it's more than just the right. And laws about living and sharing it. It's very much embodied. It isn't just something that you talk about angry reads. So a lot of my work is focusing on water justice and law. So that's where there's lots of pictures of water. So natural law and water. So this is drawing a little bit from John Burroughs and some of the work I'm doing on trying to understand how do we achieve water justice. Well, probably current laws, international, national laws aren't going to work, not helping the matter. So what do other people say about natural law and water, Indigenous law and water? So we need water to live. I always say the UN figured that out in 2010, but we knew that. It's an important part of Anishinaabe law, so there's different sources of law. Again, it comes from observing being in the natural world. Dr. Cecil King, Anishinaabe educator, talks about the law of the orders. I actually really like his work. He wrote this book on Assignat, who was one of his ancestors. And the way we started this book was, you're not going to get it unless you understand our worldview and ontology. And he spent a whole chapter describing that. You're not going to get anything I say unless you get this part. Anyway, I like how we tried to frame that so we can understand each other. But the laws weren't just about people. They were about, relationships and responsibilities to other beings. It wasn't just, humans making up stuff for each other. It was a lot broader than that. Again, this is what Cecil King talks about. So again, bigger than just people. So, this is what the Truth of Reconciliation says about Indigenous laws. So, a good portion of it was actually spent, when they were talking with the Indigenous elders who they had on their committee, they had a council of elders and traditional knowledge holders. And so, Indigenous societies weren't perfect. So there was conflict, people didn't get along, there was harm, relationships had to be restored. So people had legal orders, approaches to justice that would help deal with those kind of issues. And what they said in the Truth and Reconciliation Commission was to look to those as a way to try to resolve the kind of relationships, the broader dysfunctional kind of relationship that currently exists. That maybe there's something that we can learn from those other traditions. And I don't have time to go through the thousands and thousands of pages of examples where they give that, but it's something that I've been paying attention to, and other scholars as well. But I try to frame it within, or the way that I guess makes it thinkable or doable to me, is to frame it within the seven original or grandfather teachings. So again, Anishinaabe people weren't perfect. That's probably why we had the teachings, so that we'd be reminded so we could get along with each other and other beings in creation. So that's why you have them, because you're striving for it. And when things break down, you're like, oh, okay, maybe respect wasn't shown, so then you need to pay attention to that. So to me, these are actually, in my view, legal principles. They're like something that you're actually trying to achieve. They're not just, oh, isn't that nice, let's put it on a poster. Like, they actually mean something if you take them very seriously. These teachings. And, you know, it's my understanding, and I can't wait for it to come out, that John Burroughs is starting to write these up as Indigenous law. It's Anishinaabeg Indigenous law. People are going to have different about those. And it's not the only source, it's not the only instruction, but you have to start somewhere. So this is how I think about Anishinaabeg law. Just paying attention to my time there. So living and upholding Anishinaabeg law. So the thing about Anishinaabeg law or Indigenous law is you actually have to do it. You have to enact it, and it becomes embodied in who you are. So I was at a conference on the weekend, and I was listening to Tom Porter give the Thanksgiving address. And it was the long version. And I'm thinking to myself, how does he remember all that? Because there's the order of it. But it was very embodied. Like when he was talking about it, it was very performative. So I'm thinking, yeah, his body actually remembers what it is. Like it's impossible to keep it all in your head. So it's like in other parts of you, right? So as I'm sitting there, you know, looking at him, I'm thinking, there's no way you can keep that all in your head. Like part of it's in his body, and it's performative in terms of how he's doing it. And I thought, wow, this is a long version. Like, I'm thinking, yeah, you got fish, yeah, you get, like, because I have been around and showing people long enough to know their order. And they're like, wow, and actually, there's different orders depending on whether you're, which long house you are. But anyway, so that's what I started to realize. Like, you kind of know it intellectually and philosophically, but to see it in action, you're like, that's how it works. Like, it's actually embodied in who he is. And he did, like, it was really neat. He did this whole lecture. It took about an hour. I actually wouldn't even call it. It was, again, performative, where he talked about basically Haudenosaunee thought, philosophy, and law, and counting to 10. Like every word like meant something. So when he would say one, it, like there was like 10 minutes of like narrative around what that actually meant. And it was always had to do with connecting you back to the earth. And just like, wow, like that's like 1 to 10. Mohawk style. And that was probably the short version. Again, very performative. You can't remember all that. Like, it's embodied in who he is. So, Anishinaabeg law becomes embodied in who you are. So, this is part of my sister and I on the migration walk that Josephine did last summer. I just remember how hot that is. I'm never going to forget that. That was like hot day. And that bucket is a lot heavier than it looks. So, when you actually do it, then there's a lot of things that you remember about it. You know what it feels like to do it. You know what it feels like to, I don't know, from BI to Espanola to turn off, probably 30-odd some kilometers. And actually pretty fast, because there's a certain way that Josephine London runs them. But you actually have to do it. And then you learn it in a different way than just people talking about it, telling you about it, looking at PowerPoint. The other thing I like about Anishinaabeg law and justice is that anybody can practice it. So I'm at Osgoode, but I can't practice law. It'd be a bad idea. I know bad things have happened. But common law anyway can. But I could do Anishinaabeg law. And my 2-year-old niece can do Anishinaabeg law. So this is so we're doing a source water protection plan in my community, and we're trying to. That's a workforce to call it, but really what it is what's our relationship with the waters. And part of it is trying to revitalize a lot of the cultural knowledge. It's there, but no one thinks about it in terms of, oh, well, actually, maybe we should like plan around these. So when Josephine came, they did a water walk with the toddlers. And I think about that. She's not going to forget this. She's going to remember what it was like to carry it. Going to remember what it was like to walk up the hill. Like, you can practice it. It's accessible to anyone. And the whole idea of law and justice is not only certain people can practice this. Like, it's accessible, and everyone can do this. And your understanding of it would change over time as you get older. But it's a very different ideas about Anishinaabeg law and justice, and who it's available to, and who gets to practice it. So, the dish at one spoon, and I'm running out of time. Am I still loud enough? So, when I think about the dish, which is this one, the dish at one spoon tree, I think that it does embody, or my understanding of it does embody, so it's a treaty with Anishinaabeg and Haudenosaunee people, political philosophy, political treaty, but also a very much an environmental one based on sustainability. So, with the dish at one spoon tree, the bowl in the middle is representing, I guess now we would say, environmental and natural resources. That isn't what people said then. And that we're to share that, and it's a spoon because a fork and a knife, you could hurt people with those, and a spoon that you wouldn't. And that you're sharing it. So it's an agreement around, it's a treaty of cooperation and sharing. But in order for that treaty to have meaning, you have to have a sustainable environment. Otherwise, there's going to be conflict. We're agreeing to share. So when Haudenosaunee are in need, we'll share with them. When Anishinaabeg are in need, the Haudenosaunee will share with us. And we're going to cooperate. And we're going to think about that. So if I was to send a bowl, I do this actually with one of my classes, send a bowl around, I count how many, something that's covered anyway, people spread germs. Just make sure there's enough for everybody. So the person at the front isn't going to jam, you know, their hand full of stuff, because you're going to make sure there's enough for everybody. So if there's not a lot there, you're still going to make sure there's enough for everybody. Like, you're always making sure that there's enough for everybody. And what I like about that treaty, like when I first learned about it, it was never in formal education. It was when I would be in meetings. Usually, First Nation kind of government meetings, and they'd be talking about, like, you know, conservation and scarcity, and you know, and someone wanted to show me, you know, which people, what about the dish and the spoon? And be like, but I think at that time they didn't really want the Crown to know about it, because then the Crown would start to try to manage it. And the other thing I'll say about it is, it doesn't have boundaries. So when you look at treaties now, you can Google any one of the treaties now, and they always have boundaries, but this doesn't have the lines all over the map. Because it had to be more fluid than that, because that isn't how people operate. Like people would actually share territory. And recently I was having a conversation, actually at the conference I was at with Haudenosaunee elder, and he said they actually left areas like that on purpose that people would share, and it didn't make sense to put a line through it. But now we have to put lines on things when you're, you know, in specific land claims or comprehensive land claims. But those treaties didn't have lines. They were about the relationship. And you didn't run away when things got tough. If things were scarce, that's when you really had to come together and have the discussions. The treaties also meant that, so this is the great piece of Montreal, the Treaty of Niagara, meant that you were always supposed to come back. Again, so when the relationship gets tough, again, you don't run away, you're always coming back. What's different about our relationship? What do we need to do differently? You know, how do we need to behave differently in order for this treaty to still stand? But we didn't do that. And even with the current treaties right now, that's an issue. The James Bay or the Quebec Agreement. I mean, they sued the Crown because it wasn't honored, and that's a modern day treaty. So, but these treaties require that constant conversation. Again, relationships require work all the time. It's not like you run away when things get tough. And they won't work if you're not taken care of and you're not in a sustainable environment. That responsibility flowed out from there. I'm running out of time to talk about that. One of the reasons I particularly like this one, so this is a picture from Ellen Cormier, is because what they start to do, so those are the wampum treaties. The Great Peace of Montreal also has French writing within it as well, but what it does is it's combining traditions, treaty traditions. Same with the Treaty of Niagara, because you see 1764, the other treaties don't have that. you start seeing the numbers. But you see you start seeing different traditions come together in the treaties. So I thought if we were going to have, a covenant of reconciliation, I would think it should be wampum. Because it's not all written down, you're going to have to come back and say, what do we mean by that? Or what is that? What does that symbol mean again? Like, it requires that. Like, as soon as people write stuff down, because we do, we write stuff down and we can forget about it somewhere and put it in another file. But when it's like this and it's performative, you have to kind of be there and you have to have a discussion and you have to have, a relationship. So a covenant of reconciliation. So this was something that I thought I should have said at the time when we were asked about the covenant of reconciliation. So at the time I said, you know what, I kind of think we have enough to go on to reconcile the relationship. We already have 250 years or more of treaties and relationships that we can draw. We actually should know better by now. I don't know if we need really anything new. So, but then I thought to myself later, I said, but these things can be scaled up and down. So the dish at one spoon treaty can be scaled up and down. You as an individual, you're going to share. You're not going to be greedy, you're not going to take, and this can be scaled up to a nation-to-nation level, right? So same with the covenant of reconciliation. When I think that I'm in a university, so one picture again is Spanish residential school. The other is a university where I got 2 degrees. They don't look that much different. Isn't that kind of scary? But what I started to think was, a covenant of reconciliation, just because it may not make political sense for Canada as a nation state to take this on, it doesn't mean that universities can't. Like, you can scale it up and down. Like, I start to think about, what's our role in universities? We're actually not that good at relationships with Indigenous peoples at all. The only time we show up is when we want to study or we need educational content, for research. There's not an overall relationship that says, hey, let's have a chat that doesn't have to do with our agenda. We don't have that. We don't, and you know what, when I say that, people think, why? We just want to do that. And I say, well, guess what? Because, in Canada, the universities are publicly funded, guess off which land, and people are paid off that public money. So I'm thinking maybe, chain of custody somewhere along the line with some responsibility there. Just start thinking about Indigenous peoples as nations, not as subject matter, not as research subjects, not as a place to do research. So this can be scaled up and down. So now I think, why not? Why should there be a covenant of reconciliation with local, nations around? And that would make, the land acknowledgement a bit more meaningful. Like, do we actually really need that? Do we have relationships? And I think that's something that can be done. It can be scaled up and down. A faculty can do that, a department can do that. So now when I thought about it, I'm like, why not? And what made me think of that was a question that I got from, I was on another panel, and it was Black students and First Nations students trying to figure out how we work in solidarity, how can we be allies? I never got this question before, and I just kind of, that's a really good question. And it was one of the students, a Black student, put up his hand and said to me, so, if Indigenous nations were sovereign, could we have had a treaty? And at first I went, no. I was such an idiot, really. That's probably why I'm not getting invited to the Royal Sport people meetings anymore, because I can be such an idiot. But then it was because I was locked into, the Crown would never approve of that, because I look at the self-government agreement, I look at a lot of them and I'm thinking, the Crown thinks it's sovereign and it doesn't recognize Indigenous sovereignty at all, despite what they say, in policy. So that was, I was stuck in that, and then I thought, wait a minute, no we don't, we don't need your permission. Yeah, and it would probably be a nicer treaty at that. So I kind of realized that you have to think outside the box, and you need to think about different ways of thinking about reconciliation and what that could look like. And I thought, no, actually that is possible, we could do it, because, Wampum talks about having personal sovereignty as well. So to me, it can be scaled up or down. Like, why not? Why not universities having a covenant for reconciliation? You don't need to wait for the Crown to say yay or nay on this. It's something that you can go ahead and do. So, vision. So I think having a vision is important. I come from a culture where having a vision, keeps you
focused, keeps you kind of organized, gives you something. When there's crazy stuff happening, you still have your vision, which is probably why we laugh a lot. Crazy stuff happens, there's nothing else to do in the bar hysterically, otherwise we go nuts. And I always thought that should be one of the eighth grandfather original teachings was, you gotta have fun sometimes and just laugh. But this was, and again, apologies to those who've heard me say this before, but it just sticks in my head. I think about it every day. Was these words that Isaac Day from Server River First Nation talks about. And I've heard him mention it a few times, a storyteller. He talks about that right now we're in a story. We're in sacred times. We're in a sacred story right now, all of us. And we have a choice about who we're going to be in that story. We're all connected, like in the image. You could be the hero, you could be the villain, you could be the bit player, you could be the person who just stands there and watches bad things happen and not do anything. We have a choice about who we're going to be in that story, and that is a choice, that we are in this grand story, and it's a story, and we're all in it. He didn't relate it to reconciliation per se, but I do, because I'm thinking, but we are in this, and who are we going to be in it? And are we going to wait for someone to say, yeah, okay, you can have reconciliation, have enough to know? It's like, I don't think we need to. So, and we get to decide we're going to be. Who are we going to be? Are we going to be helpers to the hero? Are we going to be helpers to the villain? If you have that in the story. So I think about that, that we're always in the story, and we have a choice about who we're going to be in that story. And Gretch. That's something to think about now.